Okay, the first thing I would love to do today is a review on radicals. And so there's three things that we've learned already that's going to work together to complete our section on simplifying radicals completely, okay? So again, as I've mentioned before several times, let's just take a look at some of our terms. Whatever root we're taking, again, we call that the index. The actual symbol itself is called the radical. And then the thing underneath is called the radicand. Okay. Now, the three things that I want to look at a little bit more closely today are the product rule for radicals, and the quotient rule, and then rationalizing. And we'll use these three things as kind of post or guidelines to help us with complete simplification, okay? What it means to be completely simplified. All right, guys, remind me, what is the product rule for radicals? What's the product rule? Right, and what do I need?
Same index.
Same index, right? So product rule can be applied when I have the same index, right? So, for example, what if I had the square root of 2 times the square root of 8? Right? Using the product rule, they're both the square root, so I can combine it into a single radical, right? Square root of 16, which is really nice because that's just 4, right? What if we had, let's say, the cube root of 6 times the cube root of 4? Okay, similar problem, but now we're dealing with cube roots. What's the product rule say I could do? I could write that as a single radical, the cube root of what?
24.
And then now we're going to use the product rule again, kind of the other direction, right? And what do I do from here? Right, and what is a perfect cube inside 24? Yeah, so if I get stuck and I need to come up with some perfect cubes, how do I do that? I go to the side of my paper and do 1 cube, that's a perfect cube. 2 cubed is 8, that's a perfect cube. Does 8 go into 24?
Yes.
So then I split this up, cube root of 8 times the cube root of what? And then what happens? Simplify it down, and what do you get?
2 cubed root of 4.
Okay, this is the product rule. All right?
What's it 2 cubed?
2 times the cube root of 3. Right? The cube root of 8 is 2, and the cube root of 3 just tags along.
Okay.
Great, okay. Now, remind me, how does the quotient rule work? Yeah, so if I have a fraction underneath the radical, I can split it up into 2, right? Radical divided by radical. Or if I have 2, I can rewrite it as 1, right? For instance, what if I had the square root of 8 over the square root of 2? What would be the simplest way to evaluate this using the quotient rule? What could I do? Could I rewrite this as the square root of 8 over 2? Yes. And would I do that?
Yes.
Sure.
Yeah. Why? Because square root of 8 over 2 is what?
4.
And the square root of 4 we know, right? So definitely, if I see that and I recognize it, I'm just going to use the quotient rule in this direction, okay? A lot of times we'll go from quotient rule from here to here, but sometimes it's beneficial to go this way.
And so we get square root of 8 over 2, which is 4, and square root of 4 is just 2.
Okay? So that's using the quotient rule in that direction. Let's do a cube root problem.
What if I had the cube roots of, I don't know, 81 over 6,
something like that. Okay? This one I'm going to separate.
And so I'll get the cube root of 81 divided by the cube root of 6.
And then what do I have to do? Okay, so yeah, so perfect cubed,
3 cubed is 27. What's 4 cubed? 64?
Yeah. So we're looking for perfect cubes. Great, so we can look ahead and see that 27, I can split that up. How am I going to handle this 6 on the bottom, though? Am I allowed to have a radical in the denominator?
No.
Rationalizing the denominator, right? How do we rationalize the denominator?
Okay, here's the thing, guys. If I multiply by the cube root of 6, that's going to produce the cube root of 36.
Is 36 on the board over there? No. So does everybody see how this is not helpful? Okay. With square root, yeah, square root of 6, square root of 6, square root of 36, we know the square roots. But with cube root, we have to look ahead and figure out a cube root that we actually know. We don't know the cube root of 36, okay? So that's not going to work for us.
So I'm not going to multiply by the cube root of 6. I'm going to have to try something else.
So what am I going to try?
5 cubed?
145.
What is 6 cubed?
216.
Okay. I have a 6 here. If I multiply by 36, or 6 squared, I'm going to produce 216,
which is something that, looking ahead, I will know the cube root of that. Is everybody with me on that?
So 36, which produces 216, which will just be 6.
Okay. So that's important for us, because now I just have a 6. And then the top's going to have some work to do, right? I have no idea what 81 times 36 is, but I need to pull out all the perfect cubes inside of that. Excuse me. Okay? Okay, let's see. 81 times 36. That's a big number, but we know we can split this guy up into 27 and 3, and we still have 36, right? So 36 is what? Is there anything else that we can split that up into? What is 36 times 3?
108.
Are there any perfect cubes inside of 108? So we can use our calculator here. I don't expect you to be able to do this by your head. Does 27 go into it? Okay, so I have... If I have a 27 and another 27, then what does that mean?
9.
9, right?
9, 3.
So what's... All right, so we have a lot of numbers going on.
Yeah.
So
let's break this guy down. What is 81 times 36?
2916.
It's a huge number. Let's break this guy down.
Right, 2916. And we've already said that 27 goes into it, right? But what else goes into it? So we said 27 goes into it, and then we found another 27 going into it, right? So what is 27 times 27? Go ahead, take out your calculator. What's 27 times 27?
729.
729. Is 729 a perfect cube?
Yes.
Yes. What's the cube root of 729? So,
729 goes into this guy 9 times,
right? And this is important because 729 is a perfect cube. Okay? So obviously, I wouldn't expect you to be able to do that in your head, so you can do it with your notes or your calculator. Okay, so the cube root of this is 9. Oh, it shouldn't be a 9. This is a 4, right?
So we're going to split this up into the cube root of 729 times the cube root of 4.
And the cube root of 729, that huge number, is just what?
9. Times the cube root of 4.
Yeah. And now, question for you. Can that be simplified further with the 9 in the front and the 6 in the front? Yes. 3 can go into both of those.
3 cube root of 4 all over 2. That was a crazy problem.
Is there a way, can you not like go in and simplify it when you have the 27s? Or the 27 and 33s, you can't like individually?
Yeah, so you could have done that too.
So if you had the cube root of 27 times the cube root of 3 times the cube root of another 27 that you're pulling out of what was left times whatever, and then you could put those whatevers together and do the cube root of 27.
So you would like cube root of 27.
Yeah, which are both 3, and 3 times 3 is 9. Yeah, and then whatever would have been left over. Yeah.
Where do you get the 4?
729 times 4 is 2916? It should be. Okay.
All right. Rationalizing. Let's do another example. Rationalizing the denominator. What if I gave you this example? 1 divided by the 4th root of 2.
Is that rationalizing?
Yeah, rationalizing. What does rationalizing the denominator mean again? No radicals in the denominator. How do I get rid of it? I multiply by something that I know ahead of time is not going to have a radical anymore. Okay?
So guys, I need to look ahead. I need to multiply by the 4th root of something to obtain something
that is a 4th root, a perfect 4th power, which I can 4th root, okay? So if I don't know 4th powers, which I don't,
I come over to the side of my paper, and I look at some. 1 to the 4th is just 1. 2 to the 4th is?
16.
Can I come up with a number that will multiply to give me a 16 here?
Yeah, and what's that number going to be?
8.
8, right? 2 times 8.
The 4th root of 16 is just 2.
So I'm done with the bottom. That was the whole goal with rationalizing. Get rid of that radical in the denominator. And on the top, 1 times the 4th root of 8 is still the 4th root of 8. Okay? All right. What's next? We put all of these three things together. For simplifying. Okay, there are three things for something to be completely simplified, all right? The first is no perfect nth powers. No perfect nth powers as factors inside radical. Number two, no fractions inside radical.
Is this
10.5? Still
working.
Number three, no radicals in denominators. Okay?
You will know that something is completely simplified if you look at this list and you've got these three things check marked. Okay? There's no perfect nth powers inside as factors, there's no fractions inside the radical, and there's no radicals inside the denominator. Alright? So this is how you guys will know you are done with the problem. Alright? This is your checklist. Otherwise, how will you know? These three things. What does number one mean? No perfect nth powers as factors inside radical. What does that mean? Great. If you have a square root, you've taken out all the perfect squares. If you have a cube root, you've taken out all the perfect cubes, fourth root, so on and so forth. Exactly. What does no fractions inside the radical mean? It's pretty self-explanatory, right?
Yeah.
No fractions inside the radical. No radicals in the denominator. How do I undo radicals in the denominator? We just looked at that. We rationalize. Okay? These are the three things that you need to check each time you do one of these simplification problems to know that you're completely done. Let's do one. Let's do several, actually. All right. Example number one. The square root of 3 over 2. Okay? First thing, how do I know I even have to do anything? How do I know it's not done?
Number two, fraction inside
a radical. How do I, what do I do with that? Question rule. What's question rule say I can do? Split it up. Now there's no longer a fraction inside the radical. So everybody with me on that? I use the quotient rule. But now I have a problem, which is radical in the denominator. How do I undo radicals in the denominator?
Rationalize.
How am I going to rationalize this? Multiply by what? This is the easier one, right? Square root of 2. That gives me, whoops,
where did 6 come from?
That gives me
4.
Square root of 6 divided by square root of 4, which is the square root of 6 over 2. At this point in the problem, am I completely simplified?
Yes.
Yes. What's the only last thing that I need to check? That there's no perfect squares inside of 6 as factors, and there's not. Okay? So everybody see that? These three things, each and every time.
Yeah.
All right. They get more difficult. Let's take a look. Example number two. The square root of 72, x to the 11th. Okay. The directions on all of these are just simplify. Simplify it completely. The square root of 72, x to the 11th. How do I know it's not completely simplified? Yeah, we have perfect squares still underneath the radical, right? So what was my methodology for doing this? I split it up, which is what rule?
Product
rule, right? So all of these rules work together, guys, okay? Inside of 72, what is the highest perfect square inside of 72?
9.
I agree, 9 is a perfect square. Right? But 9 times 8, 8 still has a perfect square in it. So that means I haven't pulled out the highest perfect square. Everybody with me on that?
12.
All right, first let's make sure we understand that. 9 times 8. 9 is a perfect square, but 8 has a 4 in it. So that's not the highest perfect square. We can go higher. Well, keep going.
12 and 6.
12 and 6, neither one of those are perfect square.
10.
36. 36 is a perfect square. What times what equals 36?
6 and
3. 6 and 6, right? All right, 36 times 2, because 36 is a perfect square, the highest one. X to the 11th, how do I handle variables with exponents? What are perfect squares? What types of exponents? Multiples of 2. The highest multiple of 2 is 10, and what's left?
1.
Great. Okay? This step to this step, 36x to the 10th, 2x, that is the product rule. Okay? We use that over and over and over with simplification. Now, this first one we said simplifies completely. This one just kind of tags along for the ride. 36 is 6. What's the square root of x to the 10th?
X to the 5th.
Okay. If I asked you guys to rewrite the square root of x to the 10th as a exponent, what exponent would that be?
10 over 2. 2, the index, right?
So make sure you're excellent at going from one form to the other. That's going to help you guys understand this. So it's really just 10 divided by 2, which is 5,
times the square root of 2x.
Okay, that's it. No radicals in the denominator, no fractions. All I had to do on this one was pull out all of the perfect squares. All right, next example. The square roots of x over y. Go for it. Take a minute or two, see what you can do. Square root of x over y. Square root of x over y, what'd you do first? Split it up, which is what rule? Quotient rule. What'd you do next? Multiply square root of y, top and bottom. What rule was that? Rationalizing, okay? Square root of x times the square root of y is the square root of xy. What rule is that? Product rule. Everybody with me? Quotient rule, rationalizing, product rule, they all work together. What's the square root of y times the square root of y?
Y.
Okay. I know I'm completely simplified because of those three check marks. All the perfect squares are out, fractions and denominator is taken care of. All right, let's step it up. How about this one? The fifth root. The fifth root of 64 x to the 22nd. Go ahead, give it a shot. The fifth root of 64 x to the 22nd. Take a minute or two, see how far you can get, and then we'll just get it. The first thing that I would do if I was taking this on a quiz or test,
I'm not good with powers of 5, so I'd go over to the side of my paper and I want to look at some powers of 5. 1 to the 5th is 1. What's 2 to the 5th? 2
times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, 32. Okay, and I could stop there, right? Because I see 32 goes into 64. So are you with me on that? Great, so I can rewrite this. 32 and 2. X to the 22nd power. What am I looking for when I'm taking the fifth root? Multiples of 5. The highest multiple of 5 is?
20.
What's left over? 2. Great. If you guys can do that, you're 90% of the way there, okay? Now there's only one or two more steps. Split it up and simplify the first part.
Okay, so I'll split this up. Fifth root of 32x to the 20th times the fifth root of 2x squared.
Don't forget to put your index. A lot of students forget to write the index, so make sure that 5 is still there. Okay, and we already looked over here. 2 to the 5th is 32, so that's just 2. And what is the 5th root of x to the 20th?
X to the 4. And again, you could just rewrite that in the other form to see that.
There we go. All right, let's do one or two more examples, and then we can move on. Okay, the fourth root of 32a over 81. Fourth root. Okay, again, the first thing I would do is go to the side of my paper, look at some perfect fourth powers, and then you should be able to evaluate from there.
One to the fourth is one. What's two to the fourth?
Six.
What's three to the fourth?
81.
Great. 81 and 16, we're both going to need to use in this problem. Go ahead, finish it. Step number one, what'd you do?
Split
it up, which is what rule?
Quotient rule.
Great.
We have a 4th root of 81 on the bottom. But luckily, we know the 4th root of 81 is just
3.
Awesome.
Bottom is just 3.
What about the top? Has that been simplified completely?
No.
16 goes into 32, right?
So the top we have to split up. The 4th root of stuff I know the 4th root of
times what's left over. 32.
16 times 2.
What about this A? Where am I going to put that?
2.
Why? What would it have to at least be to put in the first slot?
4.
4, right? And we don't have that. Great. You guys are getting it. Awesome.
So then 4th root of 16 times the 4th root of 2A. What rule is that?
Product rule. Okay. See how everything is working together? Divided by 3.
And what's the 4th root of 16?
2.
So 2 times the 4th root of 2a, all divided by 3.
Okay? Simplify, simplify, simplify. All right, we just have one more to do simplifying, and then we can move on to the newer stuff. It's not really new.
All right, last one. Give it a shot. The cube root of x over z.
The cube root of x over z. Go ahead. The cube root of x over z.
No numbers here, just variables.
Cube root of x over z. What's the first step? It's always the same first step, really.
Split
it up. What rule is that?
Quotient
rule. Great. I have a cube root in the bottom. I need to get rid of it. Unfortunately, I don't know the cube root of z. But what is something I would know the cube root of? What would the number have to be for it to be a perfect cube?
One.
A multiple of
three.
So I need to produce a multiple of 3. Is everybody with me on that?
Yeah.
What's the easiest multiple of 3 to get?
Z
to the
third.
And what would I have to multiply by z to get z to the third?
Z squared.
So you guys need to multiply by the cube root of z squared, and that will give you the cube root of z cubed. Is everybody with me on that? With cube roots, fourth root, fifth root, you have to look ahead of time and strategize, okay?
Then that will just be just z. Great.
I don't have a radical in the denominator anymore. But at the top, I have the cube root of x times the cube root of z squared. I can write that as one radical, xz squared. Is there anything I can do with that? No.
No.
So you just leave it. Okay? So those three rules, guys, product rule, quotient rule, rationalizing, comes up all the time throughout your simplifying. Okay? That's all it is of, simplify.
How does z squared exactly?
So what perfect powers are, I mean, what numbers as powers are perfect cubes? It's any multiple of 3. Okay? So I only have a z here, but I need to get to a multiple of 3. So the first multiple of 3 is z to the third. So the question now is, what do I have to multiply by z to get z to the third? And that's z squared.
To make sure there's no radical.
Right, to get rid of the radical involved. Exactly. Yep. Okay, the next little bit, the next little section is really easy and quick because it's stuff we've already done. So now we're putting function notation together with radicals. This is it. So for example, f of x is the fifth root of 1 minus x squared. And they're going to say find f of 1 and f of 3. Now, this looks incredibly difficult if you don't understand function notation and you don't know how it works, okay? But this is stuff we've already done before, right?
Is this section 7?
This is the next one. Yes. So what does f of 1 mean? What do I do? Plug in 1 for x. Great. The fifth root of 1 minus 1 squared. What is 1 squared? 1. What's 1 minus 1? What's the fifth root of 0?
Zero.
Any questions on that?
No.
Fifth root of 0, what times what times what times what is 0? It's only going to be 0. Okay? How does this function notation work? You're plugging in a 1 for x. All right? So it's reviewing stuff that we've already done before together with radicals. All right? F of 3, go ahead, do that one for me. Fifth root of 1 minus 3 squared. 3 squared is 9, so 1 minus 9. The fifth root of negative 8. Anybody know the fifth root of negative 8? Probably not. But here's what they're trying to ask. Can you take the fifth root of a negative number?
Yes.
Yes, you can,
yeah.
Right? Because a negative to an odd power is still going to be negative. So yes, I don't know what the fifth root of negative 8 is, but I know it's not, you know, if it was a square root of negative 8, what would we say?
No solution.
No solution or not, not a rational number, right? So that's it.
There's nothing I can really do with that one.
Fifth root of negative. All right, the next thing they're going to test is how good you are at switching forms.
What's all these examples of? 10.5? Okay.
All right, how about this one? F of x
x
raised to the, they're just going to give you a power this time, 4/3.
And then evaluate f at
negative 8 and 27. Okay. So let's do negative 8 first. If I plug in negative 8 for x, what does it look like? Yeah, so if I look at it in this form, good luck, right? That means nothing to me. I need to know what it means in radical form.
So you can switch it.
So switch it to the next form. You get the cube root.
Negative 8 to the 4th power.
Do I know the cube root of negative 8?
It's
negative 2.
What's negative 2 to the 4th power?
Negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2?
16.
Okay. Question on that one. Be careful with a minus sign. That minus sign is in parentheses.
Yeah, sure.
Underneath the radical, it's like an understood parentheses. Remember, at this point, you could raise it to the 4th first and then cube root it, or you could cube root it first and then raise it to the 4th, okay?
Whatever's easier. Usually, it's easier to take the cube root first. Why? So you'll work with a smaller number, right? All right, D27. To the 4/3 power. Cube root of 27 to the 4th, which is?
3 to the 4th, which is? Boom, we're done.
Okay. All right. The last thing they do is try to trick you with negative exponents. Remind me, by definition, what is x to the negative 2? What does that mean?
1 over x.
1 over?
X
squared. It's the definition, right? Our meaning behind x to the negative 2 is 1 over x squared. Okay? That's important for this next problem we're about to do. F of x is x to the negative 3/4. Evaluate
f of 0, f of 1,
and f of 3. Okay, the very first step is that negative exponent. Let's rewrite it. What is x to the negative 3/4 equal? 1 over. And what does that mean? Put that in radical form for me. What's the index? 4th root of? Is everybody with me on that?
Yep.
So now it's easy to plug these in. If I'm asked to plug in 0, what happens in this problem?
Undefined.
Undefined. Why?
Because you can't.
No 0 in the denominator.
Yep.
Undefined. Okay, all the rules that we've been learning still apply. If I'm asked to plug a 1 into this thing, what happens? The 4th root of 1 is 1, 1 cubed is 1. You just get 1 over 1, which is 1. If I'm asked to plug a 3 into this thing, what happens? I don't know. Got to plug it in, right? So you tell me. You have 3 times 3 times 3, and the 4th root of that. So what is it? 1 over the 4th root of? 27. Now the question is, do I know any perfect powers of 4 inside of 27? I don't know. I'm not good with powers of 4. So what do I do?
1 to the 4th. 2 to the 4th is? Does 16 go into 27?
No.
3 to the 4th? 81.
All right, guys. I have my work cut out here. What do I have to do? Multiply by the 4th root of 3. Does everybody see why?
To make it 81.
To make it 81.
Because I know the fourth root of 81, which is?
3.
What's the numerator going to be?
4 root of 3. This is a really good problem. It pretty much encapsulates everything that we've done today. Okay?
Questions on this?
At this point, guys, we have finished